Good evening, everybody. Today we're going live from the Women Inspiring Network, and today we have with us Vani Murthy. She's a founding member of Solid Waste Management Roundtable, a TEDx speaker, a compositing enthusiast, urban farmer, and I can see she sent me a request. Totem time. And her knowledge on recycling kitchen waste into composite and using it to grow herbs, flowers, fruits and vegetables is held in high esteem. Thank you, Vani ji, for joining us today. And I was telling all our viewers about the Women Inspiring Network. It's a platform to create, share and inspire women. We took shape during lockdown last year. And it's a movement to pay it forward. And we are very, very glad that digitally we've had a 20 million reach already with our collaborations with partners such as Inox on our film series, Business World, OBT Carpet on sustainability, Brain Jain Memorial Trust, again on environment and sustainability. So there is a lot which we've done. And so I'm not going to take so much of the time of our viewers, but if anybody has an inspirational story to share, they can definitely share with us and DM us on the Women Inspiring Network. And Vani ji, I was just reading your profile. It was so interesting. And in your own words, I want to tell us about your journey and this virtual chapter in your life. You have such a huge following on social media. So please throw some light on that.
Yeah, thank you, Stuti. Thank you so much. And it has been an awesome journey, I must say. It started way back in 2007. And I have been a homemaker all along. It is kids and in-laws and all that. Never explored anything outside home, actually. But then when the kids grew up, I thought, let me see. So I just went and joined the Resident Welfare Association. And that's where everything started for me. This is understanding what a citizen can do to improve conditions for themselves in their area when they are in a group, and how they can interact with the, authorities to get better, roads and better lights and water and also and garbage. So how garbage, efficiently garbage. So the thing is, trash chose me, I didn't make a choice, but that's what happened to me. And it was so exciting to go into that process of how we all can become responsible, more responsible for the waste we generate. And forming this team, we had this very, concerned citizens that came together, and we formed a Solid Waste Management Roundtable. And then after that, it was about campaigns, about sensitizing citizens, about getting them to say no to a landfill, and how to reduce the amount of waste by, refusing, and how you go out composting and, collect your dry recyclables for recycling. So all these were part of the journey, and I have been doing it for more than 10 years, and COVID happened and the virtual world opened out. I'm not new to social media. I've been from 2007, I've been on Facebook. I've done a lot of YouTube videos, and I was on Instagram from 2013, but I never ever thought that it would explode like this. Not just Instagram, but the kind of virtual sessions I have been doing, the number of webinars. I've never done a webinar before that.
Do you think that has grown more so from last year, especially the pandemic?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So that what really opened out was the virtual world for me, because I have never done so many workshops in such a short span of time. Even the entire 10 years that we spent trying to, get citizens involved, the number of workshops that I did was not even anywhere matching, what I have done in this 1.5 years. So it's been the virtual world has been very awesome. It has gave me the opportunity to stay in the same mission and, continue doing what we're doing, getting more and more people to be involved in the waste they generate. Yeah,
that's so amazing, because as I was telling you earlier, the Women Inspiring Network was also born last year during the lockdown. And we on an average have got 500 voices of women. You know, we are 6,000 plus. In a short span, you know, our membership, our network has grown so well. So I can totally understand and relate to it, because that's how you connect with the millennials also today. So it's really great with all your knowledge, you're able to do this virtually and, you know, invoke that spirit in all the youth, which is like more like be the change and how we can be the change, you know. That's also another interesting series which we had started. And so tell me, how did your Solid Waste Management Roundtable, the project, came about? If you could throw some light on that.
It was just people coming together. I think somewhere the universe plays a role in, you know, it aligns in such a way that people with very clear, you know, understanding of what they want to do come together. And that's how it got formed. People from different places, came together as a team to start looking at, you know, what we can do as a group of concerned citizens. And SWMRT got formed. It was just volunteers, you know, it was a kind of practitioners who were talking about things that they have already started putting in their lives. So that's how we formed. And we're still going great guns, rolling out campaigns, influencing policies, you know, looking at the circular economy and everything that needs to be done in a decentralized waste management, and trying to get less pollution out and more, you know, get the land back into being with full of organic matter, that is composting. So we're trying it both ways, less pollution and more regeneration.
So I was just reading that you also spoke at TEDx, and incidentally I have curated a TEDx Janpath, which was in association where one of our main partners was American Center, the American Embassy in New Delhi. And you know, I've also spoken at TEDx in Tokyo, and I wanted to know your experience on that, and what was the topic you spoke about, and if you could throw some light on that.
Yeah, so the first TEDx, I have done two TEDx and I've done multiple online during the pandemic for colleges and other stuff. But the first TEDx that I did was TEDx Bangalore. And I was very nervous because I haven't spoken so formally, you know, doing a presentation on a stage, and it was really nerve-wracking for the first attempt. But then it was sharing my journey, you know, into being this person who talks about composting all the time and talking about trash all the time. So that was a great, you know, exposure for me. There was the video that went, you know, that was TEDx video that I could share. And yes, it felt good because the other speakers on that day were also so awesome. And being a part of that kind of, you know, lineup was very, very nice. And of course, TEDx SWMRT with it during the pandemic. We had this global movement, the countdown for global warming. And we registered ourselves, and we did, and all the members of our team had this, you know, we had a one-day event. I mean, it was just one event, maybe 2-3 hours. So we had the TEDx talk, each of us had a talk. So that's also gone on to the TEDx platform, yeah.
So you, of course, believe in this mantra, don't waste your waste. What's your take on it?
Because most people think waste is something that is done with. I mean, I'm not using it anymore and it just has to be discarded. But we, being in this field, we realize that waste is a resource, you know. So it cannot be wasted. You have to recognize the resource in the waste. Like 60% of your waste is from your kitchen. It's organic matter, 60%. And that's an amazing return resource to be put back to where it belongs. It belongs to the soil, not to the landfill. And also there are so many recyclables in your waste. If it is kept clean, it can go back to the circular economy. It can go back. There are many people who depend on recycling. So you are, you know, giving dignity to them. At the same time, you're providing good stuff for recycling, you know, clean stuff. So definitely waste is not waste. It is great resource. But it has to be recognized. You know, for that you need awareness and you need to understand what you're generating.
I can totally understand that. So I also use my kitchen waste in my garden. So I can totally relate to that. And is it true that you're not using any sort of chemicals at your home? And tell us more about the natural cleaners which you use at home. Because now everybody is talking about natural, whether it's on beauty, whether it's an environment. So I would like you to speak a bit on that.
Yeah. So it's a while now since I stopped using any chemicals at home. Because once you realize that all the chemicals, all the cleaners have chemicals. And even your beauty products, your shampoos, everything has chemicals. And what is it doing? Once it leaves in the waterway, it gets down your drain. Where does it go? It's hurting the ecosystem somewhere. It goes and reaches maybe some lake, ocean, or it gets into some place where the ecosystem is getting stressed because of the chemicals. So once you get to know that it's not good for the environment, it's not good for us also, because these chemicals slowly, you know, they percolate into your body and it gets absorbed and it's somewhere it is harming you too. So I started off with first making my own bioenzymes. That is, you know, it's an all-purpose cleaner to clean your home. So you can do away with your Harpic and your anything that you use to clean your bathrooms or home, your mops, everything can be replaced by the bioenzyme. It's nothing but with citrus peels that you make. There is a proportion to it. You can Google search and find out. So I put the bioenzyme, dilute it and put it in a spray can. And this spray can go, I spray it on my stove, on my platform, on my tiles, on any surface that needs cleaning. Just spray it. It smells very citrusy and nice. And then you wipe it off. Same way, you know, for your mopping the house, a spoonful of it or a capful of it into your mopping bucket and it cleans your home. And of course, for personal care products. And also if you need soap, like your dishwasher or your laundry, that you have to go back to days when your grandparents were using soap nuts. It's called the Rita. So these soap nuts, when you soak it in water, it's soaked in hot water, it lathers like this. So it's got a lot of soap in it. So you squeeze out all the soap. And then you can keep it in a bottle. And that is the one that I use to wash my dish. I also add a little bit of bioenzyme and this becomes my shampoo. I use the soap nut liquid for shampoo. Or you can also use the shikakai and soap nut powders. You get the powders in the market. So this is the shikakai. It's a pod. And the soap nut is another pod. Both are, you know, they both are the ones which have the soap in it. And they can be used to, you know, for any purpose that you need soap, that you need to clean. And of course, I get my, you know, body soap from my friend of mine who packages in a cardboard box. I use it and send back the box. She just lives down the road, you know, so that, you know, you move away from things that are, you know, on the shelf, which are loaded with chemicals. Cold pressed coconut oil. That's an all-purpose, you know, treatment for you. It's like for your hair, for your body, you know, anything. Even if I have a little boil on my tongue or my throat is itchy, I gargle with cold pressed coconut oil, virgin coconut oil. And this, I buy it in bulk in a big bottle and then take little and it's always in the bathroom. So things like that, you know, I have the shikakai powder in this. So whenever I have oil on my hand or if it's very greasy, I just, you know, sprinkle it and then wash it off. So it uses less water. Natural soaps or natural things that we are using use less water and it cleans very quickly. So we don't really need chemical cleaners to clean our home. With the two hands, if you could just scrub any surface with the bioenzyme or the soap nut, you have your house clean. So moving away from chemicals has been another, you know, landmark where I feel proud that I'm not contributing to the ecosystem in a negative way. Whatever goes out of my house is also very positive, that it is biodegradable. All of them are biodegradable and it doesn't hurt the ecosystem.
What a nice thought. In fact, Shaila has asked, I don't know if you can answer this, but ma'am, I have serious problems with insects eating away all the leaves and the new leaves are just drying up. Please advise.
Insect eating leaves, well, if you're in the garden, it will attract all kinds of pests. It'll have, you know, butterfly babies that caterpillars could be eating your leaves. So you need to know whether these are things that we need to let them survive, because I have curry leaves, curry plants, which are dedicated to butterflies, because they need to survive. What's a garden without a butterfly? So if they have come and laid their eggs on your curry plant or your lemon plant, they hatch to become the caterpillars, which will eat the leaves. So I don't look at it as pests, but there are things that we need to let survive. So we need the ecosystem to live, you know. So we need to be mindful of, you know, how we try to keep, call them pests, that you're not, you're trying to protect. I want to eat. It's not for them. It's mine. No, we need to share. You know, we need to share it with others. Of course, pests are in a different ballgame altogether. There are pests that would destroy your crop. So you have to be mindful. Watch it at the first instant. Physically take them off. You know, not spray chemicals on your plants. Yeah.
Yeah. And Anushka has asked, ma'am, do you believe in veganism?
Well, I'm not a vegan, to put it clearly, but definitely I am going towards that. I'm a low dairy person. I don't eat non-veg, so it's a very minimal dairy that I consume. So yes, I cannot be called a vegan, but definitely there is an attempt to reduce the amount of dairy that I eat.
That's so interesting. And another interesting question from Stefania: are natural cleaners and bioenzymes just as effective, considering the sanitization? I mean, because of the pandemic, sanitization has become so important.
Yeah, that's a wrong notion that chemicals only can kill. Your bioenzymes have it's been tested by Smita Kamath, who has, one of the first persons to bring it out in Bangalore, especially. And she has done all the tests and it is very effective. Bioenzymes are very effective. And we shouldn't be too paranoid, because, you know, sanitization is nothing but it is how clean you are. You know, you don't have to have chemicals to clean your home or your hands. For me, even when I go out and come, I just put this shikakai powder on my hand, nicely scrubbed in water, and I am not afraid at all. So you should stop being paranoid that only chemicals and other things will take off the germs.
Yeah. And there's so much love coming your way. Love you, Bani, Grandma, and so many others. And how does it feel for you to be called Sustainable Living Ninja, Queen of Composode, an eco warrior, or even Worm Rani, while making an impact on society? So many titles, from Worm Rani to sustainability, sustainable living ninja. So I wanted you to throw some light on that.
I don't know. It's like, yeah, there are titles that people have and they want to be relate me with that. I'm fine with it, and it feels makes me feel special, definitely. And I get a lot of love. Lot of positive energy from the virtual, family that I have out there. They have been nothing but so sweet and loving. And I that's what gives me energy. I think, I have a responsibility. Any title that's given to me makes me more responsible, you know, to put out content that helps people transform to be better people on this planet. It is one step at a time. We don't have to overwhelm ourselves, but at the same time, we need to get the understanding of where to start. So I feel very privileged that I am in a space where I am able to reach out to many people.
And have you ever been trolled in social media? Any negative thoughts coming your way, or you keep yourself positive?
I don't get trolled. I say that I am pampered, very pampered. So if a comment comes which is like probably not the usual, I just ignore, because maybe they don't know me well. I intend the best for everyone. I don't push. I don't judge. It is not like you have to do. It is just sharing my practice. So it's very harmless for me to be on social media, because what I do is not being judgmental about others, but helping them by sharing what works for me. You know, that has been my way all along, you know, as long as I can show them this is how it works for me and this is how I do it and I'm excited about it and this gives me happiness. I need to only put that out. And it's amazing to see the kind of response I get, the kind of DMs I get. I can never say that.
Because yes, the kind of work which you're doing, because even we've seen at the Women Inspiring Network that we get such, seriously, it kept us inspired, especially the last wave and the second wave which came, because for my entire team to hear inspirational story has kept us motivated and inspired. And we have a question from Astha, how to remove fungus from neem plant?
I wouldn't know. let me be very frank. I don't know much about how to take care. I just let things be. please follow Meenakshi Arun. She's like the authority on plants and, you know, how to take care.
Actually, I wanted to know.
So there are, you can, I don't know, neem tree is such a huge tree. So I have no clue how, because usually trees, you don't really spray anything on them. So I have no clue what to do if
what
there is
will happen. I can totally. And so your thoughts on the ongoing pandemic? I know the pandemic taught all of us to reset ourselves. You know, I mean, that's also one of the reasons Women Inspiring Network was born, because I run a communication agency. And so I wanted to know, how have you been dealing with pandemic in your own way? What kept you positive during the last one and a half year?
The first fact is that we are privileged, it's really, it doesn't hit us like how it has hit most people. And that empathy and compassion for people who are going through really, really, really bad things is like it really hurts your feelings. And of course we try to do as much as possible, you know, support people who need our support. And for me, I stayed positive because I had this, you know, I had this work that I have been on. It's like a mission. And I think pandemic actually is COVID positive for me. It's like, you know, it's given me more things that I can feel very comfortable with doing, sitting at home, you know, reaching out to people. It has been hard on people. And we have known people who have gone through it, you know, families and friends. Yeah, you support them, be there for them. So I think that has been the way. Yeah.
And we're going to be taking one last question from our audience. Before that, how does your family feel about your work? If you could throw some light on that, and when you decided to take this up, what were the initial reactions?
I'm sure they feel that she's occupied, she's off our back off our hair. So they're very proud, you know, of what I'm doing, who I am being here. In many ways, there is a huge support. I have two sons and my husband, all my family, my extended family. Everybody is very supportive. They're very proud of me. And there's huge encouragement there.
So viewers, we are coming to the end of the session. So if anyone has an interesting question, we'll take one last question. Vaniji, what I wanted to tell you that because of the second wave, we all thought about how can we be the change. So I want a message for the youth, how can they be the change? Because it's really, really important that this habit is inculcated while they're still in school. So I wanted to sort of know that. And actually, Tefina has asked, how should one start with their sustainable journey? That's a very good question.
Yeah. First get what is sustainability. Sustainability is taking any practice that helps than hurts, and then taking it for the rest of your life. That's what is sustainability. And it's always doing one practice at a time till you get it becomes a part of who you are. So you take one practice, a good practice, it's one action that you have taken to say that you are contributing, you know, for this beautiful planet that's given so much to us, to make it better for generations that are going to come onto this planet. So be mindful of not exhausting all the resources by just over-consuming. I think it's very important for us to be conscious and mindful of what we are consuming. All these single use and throw, we should stop completely. It's very convenient, you know, switch to the alternatives that are only reusable. Reusable art alternatives, so that there's less stress on resource. And of course, you know, if you take up practices, you know, there are so many. You can start somewhere and one practice at a time, you know, right from probably changing the next time you buy a brush, buy a bamboo one, you know, make sure that, you know, you learn how to say no, complete refuse anything that is single use by equipping yourself with a travel kit which has your, you know, steel cutlery or maybe a plate, a glass, you know, and the water bottle, so that makes a big change, you know. Even if you forget once, don't beat yourself, I didn't do it, but just go on and pick up practices that make you feel good. Yeah, make you feel good, and you do it with pride. Don't hesitate. Just wear it on your sleeve and be proud of it.
Yeah, and I have actually noticed a lot of conversations around that, and I think it answered Parul's step, which you were saying, like, it could be a change in toothbrush. Like, I have a 4-year-old, but I ensure I don't buy anything in plastic for her anymore, you know. So, you know, if you start making little changes in your life, it goes a long way. And since we're reaching the end of our session, I would like you to leave us with a winning message for all our viewers, which can inspire them sitting across India.
Okay. The winning message will be, one action that you all can take is start composting. Because I would only say that it's 60% of your waste. It stops pollution at the landfill. And then you're creating great soil to grow your food. You know, when you look at food, even just growing your microgreens could give you that, you know, power-packed nutrition. And only living soil will give you that. Only soil that has life in it, which has organic matter, will give you nutrition. And pandemic has shown us that we are all down with less of immunity. So, you know, I think we all should start looking at what food we put into our body. It's very important. I realized only when I started composting and I made my choices about safe food.
And for all our viewers, I think Vaniji has a lot of YouTube video tutorials out there. And if you think someone has an inspirational story to tell us or would like to join our network, feel free to join us at our website. There's a form at the womeninspiringnetwork.com or DM us on Instagram. And Vaniji, thank you so much for joining us today. We're really, really obliged that, you know, you could spare your precious time to educate us all about it. And of course, along the way, I got some really interesting tips on what we can do. You know, our sustainability series, which we've been doing since last year, has done very well. Like, we did 100 short videos of youngsters talking about sustainability last year. And it was really interesting. And of course, now we're working with various organizations, you know, in terms of panel discussions or other things talking about sustainability. So I look forward to having you on our platform once again in the future for a panel discussion. But I really, really loved having you here. So thank you so much. Last words, Vaniji, I leave it up to you.
Just thank you and just be mindful. That's it. This planet needs caring, nourishing people. You know, we need to give back something. There's some gratitude that we need to give her for the kind of life she gives us. We don't have planet B. Right? So take care of her. You know, that's our responsibility.
Sure. Thank you so much.
And bye-bye.
Loved having you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Sthuti. Bye.